So I'm going to open this third file, 3/statistical models. Yeah, 3/statistical models. So it's another one of these RMD files. And the aim of this section is to essentially give you an overview of multiple regression and these things called factors and the formula notation. And then I'll probably just touch on a couple of examples of more advanced things, maybe just to illustrate. I'll run this first code chunk. It's just got some data sets I want to use. This is a fairly common actual approach. I'm going to use this California schools data set. It's quite a nice little data set. It's got information on every California school, the number of students, teachers, and so on. And, as is often the case with some sort of analysis, there's some preliminary things where I'm creating some new variables. So this is just to illustrate, what you might do. So I'm creating an overall performance variable that is the sum of the reading and math performance in the school. Or I'm creating a student-to-teacher ratio variable that might be useful for predicting some sort of outcomes, or computers per student, and so on. And I'm creating these little variable sets as well, possible predictors that I might want to keep. Maybe a DV of interest, maybe all the variables. And it's quite a little handy convention. Nothing special, it's a way of storing the variables so I can remember what they're all called. All right, so just in terms of basic statistics you might want to do when you start off, you're writing a methods section in a journal article or a report, you want to know the number of cases you've got. So n row will give you your sample size if it's a data frame. So yep. Okay, off I go to my method, 420 cases. If I've got some categorical variables and I want to get descriptive stats, the number of males and females, or in this case, it's the number of the schools were either kindergarten to year six or kindergarten to year eight, there's a count. Prop.table gives a proportion. So when applied to the table function, it will give me proportions. So it's just telling me 85% of the schools are kindergarten to year eight. As I said, the psych function gives a nice set of descriptive stuff for continuous variables. It's not displaying that nice on this small resolution, but it would look nicer on a better laptop or a lower resolution screen, giving you your mean and SDs and all that sort of thing. And as I said, the HMSC one's also quite nice. So anyway, that would be one way of getting your basic kind of univariate stats to, write up in a report of some description. If you want to get bivariate stats, I mean, at least where I come from, the main thing we start with is often correlations for numeric variables. You have the core function. So core for correlation. And so here is my data frame with a bunch of numeric variables which I've selected. So this is a data frame. And I run the core function, and that gives me, all your correlations between variables. You might quite like the round function. This will round a numeric variable to a certain number of decimal places, and R often gives you more decimal places than you want, so, that's a bit nicer. There we go. You can also get significance tests and so on. And as I said before, I do love the scatterplot matrix for giving an overview of what's going on. Although it doesn't look very good on this monitor. So that's just very basic univariate and bivariate stats that you might want to report. Let's have a look at kind of the prototypical example of modeling in R. And I think the most basic example I can think of is a linear model, or what we might call a regression or a multiple regression. The benefits of focusing on this is that it illustrates not only linear regression, but a lot of the ideas around notation, formulas. There's almost identical functions for other related models. So generalized linear models for logistic regression, nonlinear regression, multi-level models. All these kind of things are there, and they often use very similar conventions in terms of everything. Okay, so here's a very basic model where I'm predicting the school performance from the expenditure, I think, per student, how many receive special assistance, how much receive lunch assistance. And we have this formula that says performance is predicted, i.e. tilde, and then each of these variables with a plus are being included in the model. And the LM is the name of the multiple regression function, linear model. By default, you don't get much. You've just got a set of unstandardized regression coefficients. Now, if you like unstandardized coefficients, they're quite handy, but it doesn't look very helpful. What you do, what the R way of reporting a model is to save the results of that analysis to an object. Just, I often call it fit for like a starting kind of basic name. This fit object is what we saw previously. It's a list. So it's a list, and it contains a whole pile of stuff. So it's a list of 12 elements. You know, it includes coefficients, residuals, all sorts of things. Most of the time, you wouldn't go exploring in that object, although, you know, you certainly can. You can go fit dollar and get all sorts of stuff. But more commonly, you would run what are called methods. Methods adjust their behavior based on the argument that's first passed to it. So the summary method depends on what object is here. And this object is of class LM. It's the fit of a linear model. And so therefore, it will run a particular summary information for a multiple regression. And it's, you know, it's pretty handy. It's probably what you're used to seeing. You've got coefficients, significance tests on coefficients, R squareds, degrees of freedom, that kind of thing. Most model fit objects have a range of what they call methods. So, for example, there's a plot method that will plot various residual statistics. There's an ANOVA thing, which an ANOVA method, which gives you coefficients or can be used for model comparison. And there's a range of other sort of tools you can use. So this is influence measures, which has a range of different outlier statistics, confidence intervals on the coefficients, and so on. You can also get fitted and residual values. So predict method gets the predicted values for each case, and residual gives you the residuals of the model for that case. So you could then put that in a plot to see, you know, whether there's homoscedasticity, normality of errors, that kind of thing. The QuantSight package has standardized betas if you like them. That's often useful in psychology, at least. I'm not sure if in your area. In addition, you can also alternatively just standardize your variables in place using the scale function. So the scale function will convert, by default, will convert variables to z-scores. So mean of 0, SD of 1. And you can apply those functions directly to the formula, and you get fit standardized, and then I guess we've got now some sort of standardized betas in here. If you want to compare models, you can do that. So like kind of like hierarchical regression, if you're familiar with that concept, or other model comparison approaches. So in that case, you just save a number of fit objects. So I'm calling the first one fit one. I think that's, yeah, so I'm looking at log income, expenditure, and whether people have received various benefits, and how that predicts school performance. Now we do the same thing, but I'll call it fit two. We'll add in some new variables like a staff-student ratio, a number of students in the school, and so on. We could get summary information for each of these models and read off R squared values and so on. But we can also compare models specifically with the ANOVA method. So I'm putting in the first fit and the second fit. And that tells me that the second model is significantly better. So that's a model comparison with linear models. One thing that's really important to understand in R is formula notation. It comes across, we've already encountered it when we've been doing graphics with that tilde stuff. We've seen it occasionally with data manipulation. So it's really worth, this kind of notation for describing relationships between variables comes across in a lot of places, but most commonly in modeling, which is what we're doing right now. To make it very clear that I'm trying to be general, I'll create a data frame with the words DV for our outcome variable, our dependent variable, and then three factors, A, B, and C. So just imagine you've got three, these are three numeric variables. If you want to learn about formula notation, you can go formula, and that will tell you a little bit about, more about how it all works. But yeah, here's the basic gist of it all. The most basic thing is the tilde, which tells you what's on the left is predicted by what's on the right. So that's the default thing. In most cases, the intercept of the model will be included. So if you're familiar with multiple regression, the concept of an intercept, it's kind of equivalent to having a column of all ones in your data matrix. So by default, at least in linear models and a lot of other models, the intercept is implied, but occasionally you need to make that explicit, so in things like nonlinear regression. To do that, you just add the one plus. If you specifically want to omit an intercept where it would be implied by default, you use minus one. If you want to have more than one main effect, you just use the plus sign. If you wish to include interactions, you can use the star symbol. So if we do A star B, you'll see that we get the main effect of A, the main effect of B, and the interaction of A and B. So A colon B. We can also include that specifically by using the colon explicitly. So if there was some interactions you wanted to include but not the main effects, you could just put in the colon ones. You can do three-way interactions, A by B by C, and that'll include all the two ways and the three ways. Or you can use this exponential sort of operator to include all three ways for a set of variables, or the main effects and all two ways. I guess, does anyone here do experiments or anything like that? You know, like analyze the effect of experiments, I don't know. Yeah, so that this kind of notation is particularly useful if you have factors in experimental manipulation, you're looking at interactions. As I said before, you can include transformations within the formula notation. So this is a z-score. And that's equivalent, alternatively you can just create your own new variables and put them in. So here's creating my own z-score variable, like za, and then putting that in a linear model. So it's sort of up to you. You can either put the transformation in the formula or you can sort of create a new variable and then put that new variable in. As you've seen, a variety of symbols take on special meaning in formulas. So plus does not mean add the two variables up. Times does not mean multiply these variables. It means interaction, main effects, and so on. So if you wish to use those symbols to mean their traditional sense of like add two variables together, you need to enclose the expression in the capital I function. So if you want to include a squared, you know, you're not talking about two-way interaction, you would put that a caret 2 in the I function. So if you were doing polynomial regression or something like that. Or you wanted to do an interaction term where you Z-scored things beforehand, you'd probably have to put that in a star. Or you wanted to add two variables up, you know, you do that in a star. Yeah, so that's an overview of R formula notation. Yeah, there's quite a bit to it. Most of the time, you're probably just using the plus stuff, but other times you may want to explore these other interaction terms and so on. Another really general concept in R is the concept of factors. We've kind of smoothed over it up until now, but I've just sort of said, oh, they're categorical variables. And they can be a little bit confusing, I think. They're a little bit like character variables, but they're a little bit like I don't know what they have in starter, but in SPSS they have value labels, so you have numbers that correspond with labels. They're a little bit like that as well. So I'll just create some character data. So if we had a character variable called smoking, and you can see it's character because it's between quotation marks, if we put a character variable into a linear model, it will somehow assign one value to be a reference category. So it looks like it's made female the reference category, and it's telling you the effect of being male on height, so 13 centimeters taller. Alternatively, you can create what's called a factor. So a factor is basically an ordered, it's a categorical variable where the categories have text sort of labels and there is an order to those labels. Factors are useful for controlling how dummy coding works coding in general in linear models works. It also influences the order of categorical variables in plots. So if you're not happy with alphabetical order, factors are important. So you can convert a character variable to a factor by using the factor function. You can see the levels of that factor variable with the levels function. So by default, it's ordered them alphabetical, female, male. And by default, a linear model makes the first category the reference category. So female is the reference, effective male. And likewise, we can see when we plot, still too small. Second. Okay. We can see that it's ordered female then male, and tables as well are ordered female and male, and that may be fine sometimes. But what if you wanted to have it male then female? This is probably not the best example, but you can imagine a Likert scale being ordered by alphabetical being a problem. So to do that, you say the factor and the categorical string variable, and then you specify the levels in the order that you want them to appear. So maybe male, then female. Now when it says levels, male is first and female is second. If I run a linear model, male is the reference category, and we're looking at the effect of female. If we look at a plot, we see that male is first. And if we get a table, male is the first category. So that's probably the major benefits of using factors rather than sticking to string variables, is that you can control the order of tables and plots for categorical variables, and you can also influence the coding of linear models. Sometimes you might have ordered factors. If you're running, if you've got a Likert variable or something like that, doesn't change too much, but it does allow you to run polynomial regression. So this was a smoking variable where by default it was ordered alphabetically from heavy, never, occasionally, regular. So that's not very useful. You know, smoking obviously goes from never, occasionally, regular, heavy. So we can reorder that with the factor, and that's obviously going to be more intuitive. If we want to explicitly tell R that this is an ordered factor, we can use factor ordered equals true or the ordered function. Then it doesn't do anything by default, but some procedures will take advantage of the concept that it's ordered. So specifically, a multiple regression will do a set of polynomials. So I'm not sure if that is familiar territory, but you've got the linear effect of smoking, the quadratic effect, the cubic effect. So if that's something that is important for you to include sort of ordered predictors, then that's probably going to be relevant. A final comment about factors is when you import data with certain functions, some of them will have an option about whether string variables get automatically converted to factors or whether they stay as string variables. And sometimes this can be annoying. I don't like it when I'm expecting a string variable and I want to paste two string variables together. If you try and do that with factors, you can often run into trouble. So I often make sure that I have the default argument string as factors equals false. And that way when you read CSVs and read tables, it will automatically treat character variables as strings. Anyway, there's a little exercise on regression. And how are we going? 318. So maybe, we'll do that for 10 minutes and then have a break for 15. There's some nibbles have arrived. So 10 minutes for the exercise, 15 minutes for a little break, and then we can look at some other stuff.